we could make a start, can I welcome everybody to this meeting of the Cabinet. Thank you very much for your attendance. Can I just give apologies to Councillor Chris Quicks? She's unfortunately not able to be here, so if we could record her apologies, I'd be grateful. Okay, so let's go straight into the business. So item one is Members' Code of Conduct Declarations of Interest. There's a block interest. I think it would be useful for us to declare, because we're all school governors. Certainly on the school's budget, I think if we could register our collective, it's a personal interest really on that one. And George, I know you've got a particular, an additional interest in yours.
Yeah, I just want to register an interest in terms of my daughter is works for the vision impaired unit, and she's a mobility officer. Therefore, I'd be very interested.
Okay. Anybody else? Any other cabinet members who still have any other interests in any of the other items? No. Okay. Great. Right. Okay. So let's move on then to item two, the minutes of the last meeting. Can we agree that I sign them as a true record? Okay, so then obviously the main business today is a number of financial reports, including the budget for 2018-19. So let's just deal with some of the preliminary reports around monitoring. So I move us straight on to item three, which is revenue monitoring 2017-18 quarter three. Jeanette, will you take us through this, please?
Okay, thanks, Phil. The Council continues to plan and manage its budget in a sustainable, responsible, and robust fashion. There are enormous demands on our services at the moment, and we must ensure we will be flexible to react to changing circumstances. We continue to look for opportunities to make best use of the resources available and ensure that they are managed, used to deliver best value for rural residents, and aiming to deliver our pledges. So, this report sets out the projected revenue position for 2017-18 at the end of quarter three, which is 31st December 2017. The quarter three forecast indicates that the Council will have an underspend of £1.3 million for the 17-18 revenue budget. This is an improvement on the projected overspend of £1.2 million forecast in quarter two. The improvement is mainly due to the benefits from revising the Council's Treasury management policies regarding the calculation of its minimum revenue provision. Underlying this positive news, there remain significant pressures on the revenue budget. These pressures include children's social care, which is a nationwide issue facing local governments, and I know many you're more than aware of these pressures. Over three quarters of local authorities are having massive financial difficulties delivering children's social care. And it's an absolute scandal, actually, that this government has done nothing to address that in that. During the year, the Council has managed to support services pressures by effective use of its revenue contingency budget. The Council has also been able to provide funding for emerging in-year challenges regarding new ferry, for example, additional tree maintenance and data protection. The general fund balances are predicted to stand at over £14 million by the 31st of March 2018. This is £4 million above the minimum position of £10 million. This level of reserve will aid the Council in meeting the financial challenges it continues to face in 18-19. Just a little word on reserves, as it seems to be the issue of the day for Councillor Lewis. Who is clearly either incapable of distinguishing between fact and fiction, or he can and chooses to deliberately misrepresent this council on a regular basis in the local paper. We have to have a minimum level of reserves. It is legally, it's our legal obligation to do so. We've recently seen Northamptonshire County Council, which is a Conservative council, go bankrupt. Part of the reason why that did so is its continued use of its reserves. So for Councillor Lewis to go to the paper and keep calling on us to use our reserves in the way that he does, is at best incompetent of him, and at worst it's quite dangerous because he's going to the residents on Burrell and he's misrepresenting our financial position, and it has to stop. It really does. Okay, so the recommendations for Cabinet are that the quarter three forecast year end underspend of 1.3 million, which incorporates a 4.5 million adverse variance relating to children's services and related legal costs, and the projected general fund balance is a 14.1 million at the 31st of March 2018, we noted, and to note that officers continue to identify actions and take measures to effectively manage the overall budget and reduce the impact of any adverse projected overspends.
Okay, thanks. Thank you, Jeanette. Is, are those recommendations agreed?
Yeah, agreed.
Okay, thank you. So that takes us on then to the capital monitoring quarter three report. Jeanette, should we get, please?
Yeah, okay, thank you. Thanks, Bill. The report demonstrates the major investment we're making against our priorities. It shows the sensible and pragmatic steps we're taking to make the best use of the resources available to develop our assets to support our services to the public. So, this report provides an update on the progress in delivering the capital programme in 2017-18 as at the end of December 17. The capital programme has been refreshed in the quarter, and it's recommended that Cabinet agree an amended 2017-18 programme of £59.4 million. This takes account of reprofiling of existing schemes, new bids received, and the receipt of additional grant funding. Expenditure in the year by the end of December 17 was £26 million, and almost £13 million being incurred during the third quarter. Amongst many things has been significant investment in roads and bridgeworks, support for vulnerable people through investment into aids and adoptions, and investing in our schools and the transformation of children's services. A bid to support children's social workers with an additional mobile IT equipment has been put forward for approval, and additional grants have been received in respect of our disabled facilities grants to sheltered housing. The recommendations to Cabinet are as follows. To note the expenditure of quarter three, £26 million. To improve for inclusion in the programme and refer to council in the bid of £0.18 million mobile IT equipment for social workers, as in paragraph 3.31. And to agree and refer to council the revised capital programme of £59.4 million.
Okay, thanks, Jeanette. Can we agree those recommendations? Thank you. Right, that takes us on to item five, which is the 2018-19 budget proposal scrutiny report. And I'll just say a few words about this. I mean, I think first of all, it's to record our thanks to members of the scrutiny committees who've been looking at the various budget proposals and options that have been brought forward over the last few months. Very thorough reports which are attached to this agenda. As a Cabinet, we've taken on board all of the recommendations and proposals, and the resolution that I'll talk to in a minute will touch on some of those issues. But I think in terms of item five, if we note these reports and thank members of the scrutiny committees for their contributions, I think that would be the appropriate recommendation to move. So can I move that? Is that agreed?
Agreed.
Okay, thank you very much. Right, so that takes us then to the main item, which is the council budget. And I am going to move a resolution. Patrick has got copies which I'm sure he'll distribute. So I'll just pause a second while those start to go round. Okay, so I mean, people obviously can read the detail at their leisure, but if I can just highlight a few points in moving this resolution. So, you know, once again, we're in a position where we've got some very difficult circumstances in which we're proposing our budget. I seem to say this every year, so you know, we start the process in this position where, you know, we're facing extremely difficult cuts imposed by the government. And just to reflect a little bit, you know, since 2010, we've lost almost a quarter of a billion from our budget, which equates to something approaching 40%. Now, in any business, any organisation that lose that scale of funding, it would be absolutely devastating. And it means that, you know, we really do have to take some difficult decisions about where we prioritise our resources. And next year is no exception to that. So, you know, I wonder how long local government can go on sustaining these draconian cuts without it imploding. I really do worry about that. I suppose it's okay if you're a council in the likes of Surrey, where you can do a sweetheart deal with the government, threaten a 15% council tax increase and then get extra money. Unfortunately, we're not in that position. So we're in the position where, unfortunately, we're being forced to look at how we can bring additional revenue into the council, and we will be proposing that we increase council tax, including the social care precept, by the maximum amount, which is 5.99% for next year. But we only do that because I believe the government do not fund local government nationally in a way that in any sane world they should be doing. And I think it's almost a scandal, really, that they transfer the burden to local council taxpayers to pay for local services rather than paying properly from the Exchequer, from the Treasury, for decently funded public services. And Jeanette touched on it. We do particularly, you know, we've got huge pressures on this now, particularly in areas like social care, where we are being asked to fund increased spending. And again, the social care preset, the government have decided is a mechanism to increase spending. Again, that's transferring the burden to local council taxpayers. And also, the council tax, it's probably one of the most aggressive tax systems that I've ever come across, because we know, don't we, because we've got most of our properties in the lower council tax bands, proportionately we raise a much lower amount of money from a 1% increase in council tax than a very affluent authority like Westminster, with lots of properties in the higher council tax bands. So the system is inherently unfair, because those areas like Wirral, with the highest levels of deprivation, proportionately bear the biggest cuts. And that can't be sensible. That's not fair. And I do think that the system is a breaking point. And you know, where we are, these are the circumstances in which we find ourselves having to set the grant. I'm pleased that in the autumn statement the government at least recognised that the system was a breaking point, because they announced this fair funding review. We all know that we're facing a huge cliff face with the revenue support grant coming to an end in 2020-21, and that if something isn't done, then local authorities up and down the land will literally go bankrupt. And isn't it ironic that one of the first councils that found themselves in this situation is Tory-controlled Northamptonshire County Council, where they have literally run out of money, and the government inspector's been moved in to effectively run the budget. So, you know, that is the situation we find ourselves in. And I hope the government is serious about looking at the fairness of the funding system. But I fear that if we don't do something radically different to overhaul the system, we're going to see a lot more Northamptonshires coming down the line in the next few years. And I think that's a salutary lesson for all of local government. So, turning to the Wirral Challenge. We started the year with a savings target of £61 million, biggest amount, certainly in my political lifetime, we've had to cut the budget. So it was a huge mandate to come in. And we do that, we've done that, we've had to face that situation with what I would call, just talking about social care, we've almost got a perfect storm with social care. So we've got demand going through the roof, partly because of austerity, families in distress, and we've got government grant, government funding to the council rapidly declining. You know, it's almost impossible to reconcile those two things. How can you meet the huge demand when your budget is going down? It almost puts us in an impossible position. However, I'm really pleased that through some really hard work by our cabinet member and our officers, we're going to be in a position for next year of actually investing 20 million additional in children's social care. And I think that is a fantastic outcome, and it's a really testament, I think, to the priority that we're giving to that service by this administration. And I want to thank everybody that has been involved in that work. But I think under Bernie's leadership, obviously we've got Paul Boyce, new Director of Children's Services. I think that service is definitely going in the right direction in terms of our improvement journey. All of the indications that we've got from Ofsted and DfE are positive. But I think this substantial additional money of 20 million will give us the ability to move forward now at pace to deliver those improvements. And I'm really confident that we've got the tools now to get to where we need to get to. So thanks to everybody involved in that hard work. So the remainder of our budget proposals for 18-19 focus on delivering against our 20 pledges. And that is always my touchstone for where we put our pledges. Those 20 pledges in the Royal Plan, I think, remain relevant and important. And the budget that we are moving next year will enable us to continue to achieve against those 20 pledges. So just to mention a few of the proposals, I won't go through the detail because you can read that at your leisure. So it's good that we are focusing on growing the economy. We all know that there is a desperate need to bring more investment into Wirral, to create more jobs, to deliver more apprenticeships for our young people, to create more businesses. That's great for the economy, that's good for our young people, but it also will bring additional income into the council through, if we're building more houses, council tax receipts, if we're setting up more businesses, business rates, and we need that additional revenue to replace the lost government grants. Because I don't want to be in the position that Northamptonshire are in now, where we've literally run out of money. So the growing the economy is incredibly important for all of those reasons. And in the next few days, we'll be making some important announcements around setting up our growth company, which will spell out the detail around that. Other areas of the budget that we're proposing for next year. So we've debated many times on this council during the year the importance of improving our street scene. We'll be investing 1.5 million on extending our programme around LED lighting, which I think is good news in terms of the improving the safety for residents and all of those things that go with improved lighting. And I thank Stuart Whittingham, the cabinet member, for the work he's doing around that. A big agenda around improving our environment. We'll continue our zero tolerance approach to littering, dog fouling. We're really focusing on improving our energy efficiency. We've talked in recent council meetings, Phil Brightmore's been the champion of this, the single-use plastics debate. We want to be at the forefront of that. And also recycling is a major priority for us going forward. And I'm really pleased, and Phil's been involved in discussions around this, and I have wearing my Liverpool City Region hat. I'm really pleased that Wirral is at the forefront of working with our Metro Mayor scheme, Rotherham, about probably the most, I think, exciting project we're looking at in the City Region, a tidal barrage in the River Mersey that will bring low-cost green electricity for our residents and our businesses, and that will be a fantastic boost to the local economy and local residents, and I'm excited that we've been at the forefront of discussions around that. On housing, and we've talked about housing many times, and George, I want to thank you for the leadership that you've given on this area. We're doing a lot of work on housing, so people will be aware of the selective licensing scheme. We launched that a couple of years ago, and this is around the agenda of how can we tackle irresponsible rogue landlords, particularly in the private sector, which is a bane of, you know, many of the complaints that myself and other councillors get are irresponsible landlords and tenants not behaving responsibly. So I was really pleased that we introduced selective licensing in four areas in the borough a couple of years ago. You know, we put money into the budget that time, about 350,000, to deliver that. We will be extending, we've announced that we'll be extending the selective licensing scheme to additional areas in the borough next year. And I think that we're rapidly moving to a situation that we need to do more, and if we can find resources, we will do more to make sure that people who live in private sector renting housing have good standards and a good quality of life, and that we make sure that those landlords act responsibly. So I think that's really a really important policy, and I'm glad that we'll be extending that. Building more houses, and building more housing. We all know there's a housing shortage in Wirral. We've seen some of the challenging figures, but I'm delighted that we will be in a position very shortly, more detail to be announced, that we will be building new, the council will be investing with others in new housing units on some of our key brownfield sites, and we'll announce more around that in the next few weeks, and that's good news as well. One of the other proposals for next year that's in our budget, which I'm particularly proud of, is we've given a high priority to having adopting a zero tolerance to domestic abuse, domestic violence, and part of our budget includes investing in supporting the Freedom Programme, which is a fantastic programme that it operates in Wirral for people who experience this issue, and I'm pleased that we're putting resources into helping to tackle that problem. And I think we all absolutely believe it's the right thing to do. So I'm pleased that we've done that. So in terms of other elements in the proposal in the budget resolution, we will have to look at part of our strategy bringing more income into the council. We will have to look at increasing parking charges. There's a proposal in there for introducing parking charges in new locations, coastal locations. It's not something ideally we want to do, but because of the scale of the cuts we're having to look at. I do, however, believe that the proposed charges are reasonable and compare favourably with neighbouring authorities. The final bit of what I want to say really touches on what I think is the council's most important resource, which is our staff. I just want to take this opportunity, because I don't think we do this enough, to thank our staff, the fantastic work that they do day in, day out, delivering those vital frontline services that our residents depend on. I do want to take this opportunity to say a big thank you, you know, to everybody, from Eric and downwards to all the staff in the authority, because you know they do a superb job, and I feel very honoured to be the leader of this council with the quality of the staff that we've got. I think it's important that we recognise that. We recognise that contribution that they make. I was proud as leader that we're all one of the first local authorities to reduce the living wage for all our council staff. I think that was a fantastic step forward. But we know that over the last few years, local government staff, like many public sector workers, have suffered as a result of austerity. Effectively, we've had pay freeze in place for too long, and that's resulted in public sector pay falling behind living standards generally. And you know, most of our staff are rural residents, and I do think we have a duty of care to them. And therefore, one of the things I'm really proud of in terms of announcements for next year is we will be proposing that we agree that the national pay award of 2%. But I want to go further than that. I want to agree, propose an additional 1% to recognise the fact that our staff have fallen behind comparable local authorities elsewhere. So we will be proposing a total pay award of 3% for next year, which will bring rural employees in line with the national pay scale. And I think in the current climate, it's difficult to find the money. I'm glad that we have found the money. It is the right thing to do. It is the right thing to do. And final bit around staffing, as I've said many times, those with the broader shoulders, it's right that they should bear the greatest burden. So this year's budget includes a reduction of around £750,000 in the cost of senior management. And again, I think from fairness principle, that's the right thing to do. So in a nutshell, those are the main proposals for the budget for next year. Can I just say in finishing, I do hope sincerely, you know, this is a message that I think we should send out to the government, that they do listen to actually many people in their own party now who are saying that local government finance is broken and needs a massive overhaul. You know, I hear, I'm back to the LGA, I often hear Conservative councillors say that, and I think that's right. Just a small aside. I did hear a rumour that the Home Secretary was here a couple of weeks ago meeting. I'm not sure who she was meeting. You know, it is important that senior figures like that, I think, do engage with councils, and it's the Home Secretary. We know the issues that we've had with police cuts, with cuts in the fire authority budget. I just think it's a shame that she didn't take the time to talk about those issues with us as the leadership, our communities we represent. I understand it was a private meeting for members of the Tory group. I'm not sure what was discussed, but I think it is important that senior members of the government engage with council leaderships around these important issues. So, just to return to the budget, I'm proud that we're in a position to deliver a balanced budget for next year in the context of really severe cuts that I've outlined, and I'm really proud that we've done that, and the proposals that we've tabled enable us to meet our 20 pledges. But also, from a Labour point of view, I always say it's important that we put a Labour stamp on this budget, and for me, we are adhering to those core principles, fairness and social justice, which must underpin everything we do, and I do believe that these proposals meet that test. I think, just to reiterate, I'm really proud of the extra money we're putting in for children's social care next year. £20 million, I think, is a fantastic achievement. I also am pleased that we're able to put additional funding into those areas, the environment, street scene, housing, growing the economy, that our residents tell us are important, and it's important that we always listen to our residents, so it's good to be investing in those areas. I've mentioned the importance of areas like tackling domestic abuse, which until recently largely went unreported. I think it's good that we're putting money into that. And finally, the extra money we're putting into to our staff through the pay award, I think I'm proud that we've been able to do that. And I just want to take the opportunity of thanking our trade unions for the excellent work that they do in representing their members. I think we have a very good working relationship with our trade unions in this authority, and long may that continue. So finally, before I finish, I just want to again thank members of the public who responded to the consultation on the budget that's included in these papers. 6,000 was a really good response, actually. And we always get good responses to our budget. And Matthew, I know you were leading that piece of work, so thank you for the work that you've done on that. I want to thank the members of scrutiny committees for the help and advice that they've given to us. And finally, thank you to all cabinet members, because I know you almost start work on the budget as soon as you put one budget to bed, you start work on the next budget, and I think next year will be no exception. And particularly thank you to Eric and the team who will share for the fantastic support that they've given us to get to the position we're in today. So that's really all I want to say in terms of moving the budget for next year. I think at this stage, can I just ask formally for a seconder? George? Yeah, okay. What I want to do now, before we open it up to discussion, I think it's probably appropriate, Bernie, to ask you to just talk to the school's budget, and then we can open it up more widely. Is that okay?
Yes, of course. Okay, so the report sets out the 2018-19 schools budgets and changes to the schools funding formula. These were supported at the schools forum, the meeting on the 17th of January 2018. The new national funding formula will be introduced from April 2018 and determines funding received by the Liverpool Authority for primary, secondary schools and high needs. There's an additional funding this year for schools of 2.2%, that's 1.6 per pupil, and 0.8 million for high needs. The new formula is a soft formula for the next 2 years, meaning this funding will continue to be distributed to schools via the local formula. The formula recommended for 2018-2019 is a transitional formula, keeping much of the existing structure while introducing minimum per pupil funding amounts of 3,300 for primary schools and 4,600 for secondary schools. The minimum funding guarantee of 0% ensuring that no school can lose pupil funding, and a reduction in the looked after children's element to mirror corresponding increase in the looked after children's pupils premium. While time needs funding is also increased by 0.8 million. This is covered in paragraph 3.6.5. Demonstrates how high needs funding has been allocated, and also highlights that whilst the increased support current commitments, it does not provide funding to support priorities. 0.5 top slice, that's 1 million of school budget, is recommended to support the funding of high needs review. These details will be considered by the Cabinet this March. The base rate of early years provision providers will increase next year from £3.60 to £3.68, and there's no other changes in this area. Pressures continue on the school budgets. A 2% pay award for teachers and non-teachers is anticipated, together with an increase in non-teachers' pension costs. Schools and governors continue to make careful plans, and revised decisions will aim to keep this budget within the amount that's available. Now, all of us have been lobbied. The National Deaf Children's Society and the local branch here have actively campaigned against some of the proposals that are in the school budget. The principal argument is that the schools will have to pay for something that they don't currently pay for, and that this means that they may not have money to support their children, and that they'll be receiving less money to look after the blind and deaf children that we support at this present moment in time. The Sensory Support Service provides an assessment to support the service for children and young people who have hearing and vision impairments in school. The service, which has a budget of 1 million, is funded through the school's budget. Children with the highest needs receive specialist teaching and teaching assistant support in class. So we have 53 hearing impaired children and 35 visually impaired children who receive graded level of intervention from, some just get 1 hour and some get a full week's intervention. From September, it is proposed that the first 6,000 of the teaching and teaching assistant support a child receives, and to facilitate this, the training services has been now developed. These changes will bring about a uniform approach to the allocation of the high needs funding to schools, where schools contribute the first 6,000 to meet the costs of the SEN, SEND support. There are no planned changes to the existing sensory support budgets or staffing structures. Any income guaranteed will be reinvested into the SEN service. What I want to do today is I want to give a commitment that if any of these suggested changes have any effect on any child, we will review this immediately. So we want any parent who feels that their child has been adversely affected by the changes within the school budget to come forward immediately, and we will review and we will keep this in our view. No child should suffer because of this, because there are no changes. The council have put exactly the same amounts of money. It's nothing to do with saving money or anything. So I want to move this. The recommendations are on page 9 within the budget statement. All the views and all the letters that have been received have been noted, and we will definitely keep this under review. So if anybody feels that their child has been affected in any way, please get in touch and we will have a look at it again.
Okay, so I want to give cabinet members now the opportunity to make any contributions on the budget generally before we move to the voting. So, Jeanette.
Thanks for that, Phil. Thanks for that. I mean, yeah, just to reiterate what you said there, it's not been easy. This council has been under sustained attack from this Tory government and coalition since 2010. We've seen significant reduction in our money coming from central government. And none of us are sitting around this table came into local governments, came into politics to have to be faced with this situation year on year. But I think the difference between us and the likes of Northamptonshire, we've approached this with strong Labour values, we've approached this on an intelligent basis, and we've not made any cuts to frontline services, we've not closed any libraries or leisure centres. We have kept our Labour values running all the way through. We acknowledge how our workers here, our employees, are the most valuable assets we'll ever have, and they've helped us and steered us through some many difficult times and difficult times to come, and they thoroughly deserve to have that pay increase. And yes, it wasn't easy finding it, but I'm glad that we did, because it was completely the right thing to do. I'm also pleased that we're honouring our commitment to zero tolerance towards domestic abuse. It's something I feel very strongly about as an expert champion. And Bernie, I'm really pleased that we have the political will to make that investment into children's services, because we are committed to looking after the most vulnerable on this peninsula, and that's exactly what we're doing in this budget. I'm pleased there's a review underway around local government funding. However, it was slightly disconcerting for a Tory government minister to write to us, Phil, and to describe us as a district council, which demonstrates the level of expertise there is there, the LCG. So hopefully they might realise that our district council will look at our funding properly and start to up the game, because actually, whilst we've delivered what I consider to be a budget that's ticked all the boxes for me, it's been really difficult. And quite frankly, you know, we can't continue to keep doing this, but for this year, we've done it, and I'm really, really pleased that we've upheld all our own values.
Good, okay, Phil?
Thanks, Phil. It's a really good budget resolution, I think. The environment is one of our main priorities here. On the world, I think we're greener, more efficient, environmentally ambitious than we've ever been. I think it shows. There doesn't seem to be a cabinet meeting that passes. But I don't present some award that one we've received somewhere in one of the sectors. And I was going to say again, but for me, I happen to have this.
Do you want to say what it is for?
Oh, indeed. So our waste collection system, so that's Biffa. There's also Nikki and Andy and the team. We're a finalist for the best and most improved performer 2017. I believe we're ninth in the country, which is absolutely fantastic. I want to put and recommend my thanks to them and thanks to the team that hard work. I think it's entirely right that they're receiving that pay increase. This just goes to show, and it's not just them, also parks and the coast, and our leisure centres received awards this year. I really think they're doing fantastic work. I think the only thing that possibly undermine our really ambitious and forward-thinking approach to this council is continued austerity. And I think we've got to make it clear to the government that it cannot continue. It's a political choice and it's not an economic concern. necessity.
Can I add my thanks to the staff who were involved in winning that award? If you let me know who I need to write to, I'll write to the person today. Thank you. Right, George.
Yeah. I'm sure you know, Amy. I just want to touch on a couple of things. First of all, I think the work that the cabinet and you put yourself as the leader have done in very, very difficult circumstances over this past 12 months, been nothing short of incredible. To make sure that all our services stay intact, to protect the vulnerable in our society. And I just want to make a couple of observations, if I can, please. The highest level of deprivation in council tax comes under A, B, and C. And I was checked, I did speak about this at the last cabinet meeting, and freedom of information came in about the comments I made. So if I just refer people, if you look at page 93 in the report today, it gives you all the bandings, it gives you the properties in 2017, and then it gives you the revised properties and then the net properties. And what it basically boils down to, will in A, B and C, it's got 82% of its properties. Now, if you look at Chelsea and Kensington and Westminster, 90% of their properties are in the upper band, above the D bracket. So therefore, when we get a return of around about 1.5 million, 2 million, they come back in council tax, they get 56 million. So the difference being is massive. We can't rely on that, and therefore, as a deprived area, we should be receiving government grants to make up that shortfall. When that goes in 2020-21, we will have to find another way of raising that funding or remove the services that we so preciously hold on to. So I just want to make that point and finish off with exactly what Phil said. I was quite incensed when I read about Amber Rudd coming to the meeting last before I had to go into town hall. When you think of where we are now and where we were in 2010, and we look at the police officers that we have, and they are a top priority, there's no ifs and buts about it. Community safety in Will and all around Merseyside is still the top number one priority. And we've removed 1,300 police officers off the streets due to the cuts that have taken place over there. 550 fire officers have gone, and you've seen the changes in particular. They just used the Will, won't use the Merseyside area, but they used to use the Will, and we had all the hullabaloo about the new station. The fire officer is the person who has to deal with that. He has to say where he feels he can give the best safety for the people of Will and how they are. Now the latest one, which has just come out, which I'm sure you're all aware of now, they're now going to make Wallasey Fire Station a day-only fire station to the close at 8:30 in the evening. So we're down to Birkenhead Fire Station looking after this side of the world. And I think that is absolutely appalling. And for her to come here to speak to whoever in the Tory group and not have the decency to come and explain that to the leadership of this council, I think it's absolutely appalling.
I think there must be a leadership action in the office.
I think there must be a leadership action somewhere.
Anyway, thank you, George.
Bernie. Yes, I'm proud of this budget. I'm proud of what we've done, but I'm really proud of the commitments that we've given